you use that his banner over you, his banner over you, as if some, you know, he's in a third party, like somebody's saying it. But then God just stopped me. He said, now me they tell you, say, my banner over you is the Lord.
That's right.
Don't let anybody be giving you the story. I'm the one telling you. And it kind of like changed a lot of things in my life. I mean, I just broke down because most of us come into this world and maybe we have like three or four people that tell you that they love you. Maybe your parents, you know, the two of them. Then sometimes there's some parents who they care. Then maybe your spouse, you know. And then your children, if you have children. But God is saying, you don't need anybody to tell you. I'm telling you. My banner over you is love. Nigeria is in a very wonderful place in Jesus' name. A lot of people are, I mean, I know how many calls I get every day, so I know what's happening. Every day, people are saying, I'm not even eating for 4 days. But I want to bring you a message of love from God. God cannot love you and not take care of your issues. Honestly, I'm saying this with humility. God cannot love you and do what? And not take care of you. Love, the meaning of love is take care. That's what it is. That's not even the, that's just an intro. Jesus. Now our message, I'm praying to God that I meet up, but I will in Jesus' name. Our message today is be glorified. Be glorified. So, what am I talking about? Let's go to Romans 8:30. I'll need somebody to read. Romans 8:30.
Moreover, when you predestined, this be also called. When he called, this be also justified. And when he justified, this be also glorified.
Amen. That's what the Bible says in Romans 8:30. It says, moreover, because that means there's something before that, but we don't have the time to go into that. But it says, moreover, whom he predestinated, right? Or predestined. That says predestined. It says, whom he predestined. These, it's funny, he said, whom he predestined, I think it's one person, right? But he said, these, he also called. Sometimes we think it is a one person affair. It's not. And then he goes further, he says, from that point on, he kept using these. He said, whom he called, these, he also justified. And whom he justified, these, he also glorified. That's the purpose of our matter today. Let's go deep and say and understand what predestined or predestinated means. When I checked up on the dictionary, in the dictionary, it says foreordained. That's my best, what I took as the best, you know. It said foreordained. Then the next one says to determine beforehand, to destine in advance. When I read that, I'm like, so, what have you been doing? What have you been doing? Praying, God, do this, don't do this. It is already predestined. It says, moreover, whom he predestined, he did what? We're only talking about predestined. He said, it is foreordained. I listened to what the choir was saying. There was one song was talking about. He said, God has already done it. It is finished. That's just the first one. That's just the first clause. He predestined Jew. Don't think he's one person. Old Testament, yes. He was speaking one. Why? Because Jesus had not come. Because Jesus had not died. But in the New Testament, which is why when Jesus came, he said, renew your mind. You need to renew your mind. You need to renew your mind. It's so sad that a lot of Christians today still apply Old Testament matters into their lives. They still think like they are Old Testament. You can't even call them believers because you have to believe in Jesus to be called a believer. But they still think Old Testament. They still, you know, do performance Christianity. Performance Christianity. I have to come. I have to sing. I have to go. I have to pray. I didn't say you shouldn't pray. I have to do this. It is not what you do per se. Because if you have been predestined, it means it has nothing to do about you. It has nothing to do with you. Predetermined. The Bible says that in the beginning, there was what? The Word of God. Jesus is the Word of God. He started it from the beginning. We were not there, but he was there, but we're in him. And we are in him. And we will be in him forever. Predestined. Now, we have seen the plural form. So tomorrow, don't tell me, I was not called though. You know, I have sister, you know, studying. So when you are a Christian, stop sitting down and sleeping. I heard that. And I was like, wow, this is part of the message I came to tell you. Stop sitting down and sitting and doing nothing. Saying, I wasn't called. It's sister, Pastor Eunice that is called. It's Pastor Obi that is called. It's Pastor Tunde. You know, it has nothing to do with any pastor. It has nothing to do. Pastor is pastor, yeah. Not stopping any pastors from being pastors. But what the Bible says here is, because you are predestined, these he called. Now let's go to call. Call simply means beckon. You know, cry out. So even if you can't hear, even if your ear is blocked that you cannot hear, God will make you hear. Because the dictionary meaning of call means, you know, scream with a loud voice. Cry out with a loud voice. So that wherever you are, you will hear it. Wherever you are, you do what? You will hear it. Okay? He said, cry out, shout, cry to summon to someone in the order to summon. In the order to summon the person. So, you know, a lot of times we don't understand. It's like we say, oh, we didn't hear. And it's written there. You don't need to hear any calls, any other calls. Because spiritually, God has called you. Even the devil understands this thing. And some babalawos that will come and say, we will summon him. We will summon him. He will come here. Is it your spiritual, your physical? It's not, there's someone. It's a calling. It's a calling. I don't know why. Somehow, the people of this world seem to understand more of what God is talking about. It's as if they take the Bible, they read it, and then they go and follow. We Christians sit down on our box every day, waiting for, like I told you, that's Old Testament. Don't get me wrong. Somebody said, when I said, you know, I preached this somewhere to somebody, the person came and met me after and said, but madam, what you're saying is as if we don't need God anymore. I said, it's not possible that you don't need God. God is in you. So it's not possible that you don't need God. But God doesn't need you to behave like the human being that fell and lost his glory and lost his powers. That you always need to go to God. That was what was happening in the Old Testament. One or two people were different because they understood what was happening. Then Jesus hadn't come. But people like Elijah understood that once God is with you, it's okay. I can say anything. He didn't need to go to God to get some permissions like we, most of us think we need to do, to decree some things. He knew because he was a prophet ordained by the Almighty God that whatever he decided to do, make whatever choice he wanted to make, he would make. Because what? The spirit that is in him, that is leading him, is the spirit of God. Elijah didn't need to say, hey, let me pray, and I'll come back to you and know whether we're going to stop the rain for 3.5, you know, 3.5 years. He didn't consult with God. He sinned. He didn't consult with God. He didn't. He just saw what was happening. Say, ah, God has given me the power. Whatever I say will happen. And he said it. It didn't matter. He didn't need to go and fast for 20 years. Like I, you know, there's a people that do that. They have the grace. And I thank God for that. I listened to one man in experience. He was the one that made me start with an experience that would do House of Rock Dolls. And that was the point. He said, all his life he had never fasted. And I was looking at him. You have never fasted. And you've reached there. I said, reach there. And you have children that stopped your family. Oh my God. We must be doing something wrong. And that was when I started digging into the Bible. What are you fasting for? Jesus fasted. I think the Jesus fast is okay from you. This is my conviction. Please do not follow it. But I followed the man. Immediately, I came back. Came back from that day. I said, don't point that we all, once you open mouth like this, everybody could said he has never fasted in his life. Look at him. No sickness, no disease, no. What you believe is what happens. Bible says that as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. I'm a victor. I don't need to fast to be a victor anymore. Period. Yeah, you might say, you know, I'm fast. I know what. Jesus, don't do me fast. You do me. Come and respect me. I know what. I don't understand. I know what. Jesus, don't do it. You do me. You want Jesus to do me. They will come and say, Jesus, don't fast. Don't fast. Leave me alone. He said, he who is what? He's destined is called. That's the meaning of call. All of us are called. I'm tired of hearing people say, you know, I'm not in the ministry. Who is in the ministry? We are all in the ministry.
That's right.
Stop coming to sit down every day to hear some message from the God that is with you. Only to do what sit back down. Nothing wrong. The Bible says, do not forsake the gathering of the brethren. It's important. It's almost, in fact, it was, I must say it is something that Jesus realized that, if I just give these people all this power, everyone will be desperate. So he said, do not forsake it all. Always come, fellowship with one another. But what, in fact, let's take a little, you know, cross-country or crossing on what we do when we come to church. Most people, honestly, first thing, I gotta look good. Just come to church to show my, you know, son the best. First thing. Second thing, I've not seen Sister Tobena. Let me just come and see Hasha. Let me just, the last thing that comes is I'm coming to see God and fellowship with each other. And that's why when you come to church, there's so much discord. There's supposed to be what? Oneness. It was, Jesus said, in this oneness that I have brought to you, which is like the oneness in the Godhead, you guys continue in it. I think most of the time, your Christian sister is probably your best enemy. It's sad, but that is the truth. We need to start taking this thing seriously. We're wondering why things are happening and things are not happening for us. This is the reason. This is the reason. So we talked about call. And then the next one was justified. And, you know, I like justified because it kind of like brings it home a bit. He said justified, when I checked the dictionary meaning again, he said having done for or marked by a good or legitimate reason. Having done for / marked by a good or legitimate reason. Which means you're legit. If you understand the depth of that, which is why some, I think some Christians and some men of God have actually missed it. Because they realize that whatever they do, as long as you're born again Christian in the fold and in the family of heaven, really, you are legit. The legitimacy does not come from your stopping to sin, from your going to church every day. You like live inside the church without a belief, without being a born again Christian, accepting Jesus Christ. It's nothing. Your legitimacy comes from Christ being legit, from Jesus Christ being the only justified person. From the minute he came onto this earth, he kept telling us, I've come to fulfill that which is written about me in the volumes of the books. And then the day that came, he said, it has come. And what happened? They came and they picked, I don't want us to read it. They came and they picked him up and they did what? And they took him straight to where? To judgment. Pontius Pilate, you know the whole story. And they flogged him. Bible says that by his stripes we are healed. That's first the reason why we are healed. We're not healed because we're taking the queen. That's not the reason why we are healed. We are healed because what? Jesus has healed us. After that, he went to the step of dying. By the time he died, he did what? He died with every other thing. Every other thing that might be talking and saying we are this and we are not this, we are this. He died. That old person, that old Adam, died. By the time he died, he now went into hell and physically fought the devil, conquered him, chained him, put him in hell, locked him up in hell, and took the keys. Which is why they say he's the key. He has the key to heaven and earth. After doing that, he now resurrected. He resurrected. So he justified us. Jesus has justified us. Stop seeking for justification. Stop it. Stop it. Stop praying every day. Oh, God, I did this. God, I didn't do this. God, say, thank you, Father, for the justification you have given me. I don't deserve it. But when the court, whether the person is criminal or not, if the court, a judge says, maybe Supreme Court in Nigeria, declares somebody acquitted, acquits a person, and says this person is justified, nobody can say anything. The person could be a criminal, hardcore criminal, that probably killed, you know, in the 80s, we had a notorious gangster called Aninha. I was still young, but we watched the TV, and every time, even as we were in primary school that time, everybody was talking about Anini. We, the younger ones, had to know about it. Anini, 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 Anini. Then became a, in fact, it became, what do you call it? Popular, right? Get that Anini peradventure. Did whatever he did. And the Supreme Court of Nigeria decides to find him not guilty. He's not guilty.
That's right.
I want you people to understand what God, because this is a summary of who a Christian is. This is a summary of who a Christian is. You need to carry it along every day. Have it in your mind every second. As let it be you. Let it be you. Okay? Let it be you. Now, he says, him who he has justified, he has what? Glorified. When I checked the scripture, it said, praise and worship God. With music and all that, you know. I said, give praise to God. Basically, he was trying to say that. Now only God will. This is what we do to God. Say, praise and worship God. I thought I was going to see them say something like, you know, you are, you know, giving some kind of appearance or something. No, I didn't see anything. So he kept talking about God. What does that mean? God has brought us back to his image. Again, repeating again. New Testament, not Old Testament this time. New Testament. Again, he has what? Glorified us. Put you high. There on earth, you are the highest. They say there's a food chain. The Christians are the highest on that food chain. But unfortunately, because our minds have not taken it, we are where? At the bottom. Our minds are still at the bottom. So we are struggling with the Muslims, the Hindus, the whatever you call them, because really, it's not the physical that matters, it's the spiritual strata that matters. And you see people, they say, come, I'll take you to the seventh heaven. Who are you to tell me that you will take me to the seventh heaven? I am in heaven. How dare you come and preach to a Christian and market levels of strata because you do not know, because you think you are down there with them up there. And you see some people, they are fighting. The Bible says, our battle is not carnal. It's not carnal. We wrestle against spirits. But you will see mostly Christians anyway. Something happens to them, they are wrestling it physically. Either they quarrel with the person, or they go and make a call and put a call and give the person a stinker. Is that what the Holy Spirit led you to do? Of course not. If you listen, if you were led by the Holy Spirit at all, you will see that the Holy Spirit will always say, peace. The first thing Jesus did and does anytime after he died and resurrected, first thing he says that comes out of his mouth, he says, peace be unto you. So the first thing the Spirit will lead you to do is do what? Peace. First. I heard Pastor Yuni saying, focus on your calling, focus on what God has called you, focus on being a Christian. Stop allowing the devil to distract you, because all that is the devil. I remember listening to Archbishop Idaho Sawon, because that's one of the levels most people have done with you today. And he said something. He said, how many of you have ever challenged a headache? Just ordinary headache. You can't challenge it because you think it is okay. The devil has convinced you that it's okay now. You stressed yourself, right? But you know you did. You know you went to Cotonou, then went to Ghana, then from there did a round trip and came to Abuja. And from Abuja, you should have a headache. Don't worry. It's a lie! You don't have no headaches. Spirits don't have headaches. And he said, how many of the ordinary headaches have you challenged? Before I start telling you the one you will challenge. The big ones that you will challenge. Is it death you will now challenge if you cannot challenge headache? And from that day I took a stand. Anything I feel, I said, come on, get out in Jesus' name. And you should go, funny enough, because the devil has been lying to us. He just comes and, you know, he just eats up on something, he's not feeling pain. Say, hey, let me go to the hospital. Of course, he's already waiting to tell you that it is cancer. They're waiting. You don't come. How many people have you heard that cancer healed? That it was actually, you know, medication that healed. The ones I've heard, they took a stand. Some of them, they told them that you're going to die in two weeks. They said, okay, they take me home. They went home. There was a woman I heard. She went home after going home. She, every day she told her, please play my music. And I just want to worship God every day. Since I'm going to die. And she's still alive today. Because she changed her mindset. He justified, he glorified. Let us see what a little bit of what glorified means. He says, describe and present as admirable, especially unjustifiably. That's a dictionary this thing. He says, describe and represent. So it's a physical. For some people, they think they're going to wait till they get to heaven before they get to heaven. You're already glorified in heaven. Where you live is here. Anybody who enter heaven, don't be Jesus Christ. But what do you need glorification in heaven for? You need it here. So he says, describe and represent as admirable. It's admirable. Especially unjustifiably. I checked these two words, justify and glorify. I checked them before. But they went together. Especially unjustifiably. So it's not for you. You're not justified for being called for God glorifying you. You're not justified. And stop thinking, you know, the way you see yourself is the way the world will see you. Do not wait for the devil to tell you that you are an ant. Jesus Christ tried to say, he said, you are the head and not the tail. You are the head. I don't care if you're born as a last born in your house. What Jesus says is that spiritually, you are the head and not the tail. There's something that comes with being the head. You own a crown. It's automatic. Jesus gave it to you. Stop walking like an ant. Like, you know, what is it that walk like, you know, put their tails, scary cats and all that? Stop walking like that. That's the spiritual structure of a lot of Christians is that. Unfortunately, they are under, they are the tails. Unfortunately, you need to understand that you are the head. Remain in the head. Understanding what glorify and being the head. Now let me put a little, I want to just talk literally to it. The characteristics of, you know, the glorified. And please put John 20:17 for me. Okay. He says, Jesus said to her, do not climb to me or cling to me. For I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren. Automatically, the people you used to call disciples, they automatically became brethren immediately he resurrected. He said, go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father. Automatically. He said, and to my God, your God. Previous to that, we didn't have that authority until Jesus died and resurrected. Because some people lay a lot of emphasis on just dying. No, he died, conquered, and resurrected. When he resurrected, Mary Magdalene was the person that saw him, realized it was him, and wanted to go and cling on him and run. And he said, don't touch me. Do you know why he said that? Because Mary Magdalene had not yet been glorified. He had not yet been glorified. She had not yet been glorified. Nobody else had been glorified. Jesus was the only person who had the authority. So he said what? He said, I have to ascend to my Father, your Father. To my God, your God. First, what was he going to be unto then? He was already, you know, he had already been resurrected, which means everything that was carnal was dead. And he became a spirit, basically. And then for God to now stamp on it. He had to go to heaven first before some
every person, Father must
think. That's part of the whole thing in place. And then you have to start from the beginning. So he went quickly. When he went there, he said, don't tell my brother, let them gather. When they gather, I'll come and see them. And if you read further, you will see where Jesus did what after he went to heaven, he did. They didn't show us that account. Jesus didn't want to show us. But if you pray to God enough, you understand what I'm saying. If you are in the presence of God, you will open your eyes and you will understand. When he went to heaven, God now declared him the king over everything on earth and everything in heaven.
That's right.
He was now power. He said, this power that has been given to me. What did he say? Give it to me. But when you go down, you will see where Jesus came back as the God. Guess what? Jesus did not go. He just appeared. Was he doing that before? Read your Bible, he says. I'm not like this. God said, come, let us go. You don't throw away your sense. There's a reason why God gave you sense now. And there's a reason why he didn't give animals. He gave you sense. There's a reason. Read your Bible with sense. What did he say? He said, I will come and meet you. And when he came, I don't know if I have it here. But when he came, what did he do? He got into the place where they were. And immediately, he left. He told them to gather. He told them to, the same John 20, Father down. He told them to gather. And when they gathered, what did he say? He said, he endued them with power. Because now he has the power. So the same glory he had, what did he do? He acted it. And immediately he said it, he said something. He said, go and feed my flock. So, when you see that and when you get that from Jesus, what does that mean? Your glorification is not for beauty. Your glorification is to do what? To expand the word of God. I will take just one more example of Paul. Please give me Acts 21:10. That should be our, you know, because this Paul, a lot of you know him. Let me introduce him a little. He died, or rather, he was a Roman soldier that was persecuting Christians. And after a while, he persecuted with the right mind, with the belief. He was doing this persecution because he believed that, you know, he was fighting for God. And I believe it's because of that mindset that God now picked him up. Because he was so zealous. He would kill anybody who didn't bow down to whatever they believed God was. He would kill the person and say, who are you? Come on up! Like Muslims are doing today. You know? And what did he say? He got blinded on the way to Damascus where he was going to perform a killing. And the whole story changed. God told him, we are going to worship. You are going to, Paul, it is me. I'm the one talking to you. Shall you say it's God that you are killing for? I am God. Say, are you God?
Who are you?
Say, you don't think I'm God after blinding you? The same me can put your eyes. Okay, put it in that. You must be God. Surely, Messiah listened to God from that henceforth. And I know why God picked him. You can't see the things Paul did. Even Peter, that was the closest to Jesus, didn't he? John, that was the over close self, they see for your breath. All of them, nobody. Paul! You can't read the New Testament without God. In fact, most of the New Testament epistles, these letters that they wrote, is understanding. Okay? Let me say this is said as we stayed many days, yes. But you go on there, this is just the beginning. So that we can read it. Say, as we stayed many days, a certain prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. When he had come to us, he took Paul's belt, bound his own hands and feet, and set Thus saith the Holy Spirit, so shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. Continue. Now, when we heard these things, both we and those from that place placed with him not to go to the, pleaded with him not to go to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, what do you mean by weeping and breaking my heart? For I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die at the Jerusalem for the name of the Lord. Go ahead. So when he would not be persuaded, we see saying, the will of the Lord be done. Will of God. Hey, sisters and brothers, will of God. Time does not permit us. But if you read the account, you will find out that Paul didn't listen to will of God or no will of God. Do you know what? He is glorified. He knows the meaning of being glorified. He knows the meaning of being glorified. Even the Holy Spirit could not stop him. Even God himself, I mean, I dare to say, couldn't stop him, because that was the word of the Holy Spirit. That was the word of the Holy Spirit. Paul went ahead. He went ahead. He didn't stop. In the middle of the night, Jesus came to him and had a conversation with him. Came up with him and had a conversation. And said, you didn't want to do this. So I'm going to do it, my master. It don't matter if I die, I die. Hallelujah. Woo! You have to have such level of faith. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, well, I'm not going to bow down. Whatever you want to do, do. Decide. And the king decided. Say, I'm going to throw you into fire. Say, throw us. We know the story. When they got there was a fourth man. Now, in the Old Testament, there will be a fourth man. I heard some people preaching, fourth man. Hey! Wake up! There is no more fourth man. You are the fourth man. Because the Spirit of God lives with you. In the olden days, the Spirit of God did not live with you. He is to come. So before anything can happen, he comes. So Paul is a New Testament person. If you go and check, he just decided, now be the Holy Spirit now. Now be the Jesus Christ here on earth. I represent him. Jesus, would you have stopped? Jesus wouldn't have stopped. Jesus, because nothing will stop. Nothing will stop Jesus. And he understood that. And what the next thing he did, he went, he conquered. He conquered. They almost died. They almost died. Do you say, no, we are not dying? Put your feet down and tell the devil no. Stop accepting whatever the devil hands down to you. Stop accepting. Stop accepting it. The only way you can get to that point is if you understand the meaning of being glorified. One fetish person met me once. And one day, you know, as he met me, I noticed he was looking at me in a very funny way. He was looking at me. I said, you see this one? I don't know, even say, high priest. I don't know where I'm from. So I said, what is this one? I didn't know. Then one day, in the course of the event, as it was a party, guy came and sat right next to me. I said, this one they try and say, I started speaking in tongues. And the guy told me, say, I'm attracted to you because of the light I see in you. I see the light. I can almost touch it. I said, touch him now. You go born. His father on went and said, wow, you are the daughter of God. That time I should have been doing like this. But the devil took a quick pride. And once pride comes, it will not change. So I was like, okay, so it's those things who I don't know. He's like, Papa, in my heart. Ring, I should come to the lake, no kaka. And he said to say that he put you to and, you know, before I know what was happening, that guy, he tried to be my friend. I said, I know they're your friends. Jesus Christ level like you. He said, yeah. I know what. No call me. No do anything. Leave me alone. I am. Because when he says, yes, I am born again. He said, but you have seen so many born again. The ones that talk, they are born again. But meanwhile, there's nothing in there. Is that who you want to be? Now, this message is not be glorified. No, it is a command. Now I've taken a little bit of time, but I just have to finish. It is a command. How badly do you want it? How badly do you want to be glorified? That is the only way it works. Because when you are glorified, then Jesus, God, and the Holy Spirit can work with you. Thank you.